Harper Perennial and Harper Audio present Confident Women, Swindlers, Grifters, and Shapeshifters of the Feminine Persuasion by Tori Telfer. Read by Jaime Lamchick. In a twisted way, she resembles the skier or the mountain climber. One imagines her asking, "Will I make it again this time?" Dr. William A. Frosch. Introduction. Charming. In 1977, the New York Daily News published an article about a beautiful young con woman named Barbara St. James. At least, that was one of her names. "If you meet her, you will like her," ran the article. "She will draw out your life story, your troubles and triumphs. She appears wealthy, a woman of substance and class. She drips with sincerity." "Appears" was the second most important word in the paragraph, but the first was "like." You will like her. Beautiful Barbara's life story has long been forgotten, but that line could be used to describe almost every con woman before and after her. If you meet her, you will like her. The con woman's likability is the single most important tool she has. Sharp as a chef's knife and fake as a theater mask. Without her likability, she would be nothing. If you like her, and you will like her, then her work will be so much easier. It'll all be over quickly. You'll hardly feel a thing. The fact that we like con artists so much is probably the greatest con of all time. How do they pull it off, these criminals, creating a world in which we call them confidence artists, while other criminals get unembroidered titles like thief and drug dealer? Why do we call their crimes playing confidence tricks, like we're talking about a mischievous toddler? When journalists, lawyers, and lovers spoke about the women in this book, it was as though they were remembering a brilliant performer who had sadly lost her way. The woman would have been a great human creature had she been highly trained, highly educated, wrote one journalist about a Canadian con woman. The brother of a British con artist insisted that if it weren't for an unfortunate quirk in her character, she would be a wonderful, wonderful person. In fact, she is anyway. The lover of a French con artist said of her, "Without being aware of the danger, I admired this brave spirit that was checked by nothing." The brother-in-law of an American con artist declared, "She's one of the nicest persons I ever met." There's no point in denying it. The women in this book are extremely charming. Most of them would be fantastic company on a bar crawl. Many had great taste in fashion. The designer handbags, the fur coats. Some could do fun accents, others could tell your future. One drove a pink car, while another had a license plate that read 1RSKTKR, number one risk taker. The most dangerous one had a habit of giving out $100 bills, just because. Delightful. Clearly, these women would have been entertaining to know, assuming that you stayed on their good side. But why do we feel so comfortable admiring them? You can't go around gushing about how your serial-killing sister-in-law is a wonderful, wonderful person and a brave spirit that was checked by nothing. But the internet is choked with articles like "Why We Are All So Obsessed with Scammers" and "How to Dress Up Like Your Favorite Con Artist for Halloween." A simple explanation for all this adulation is that con artists have a reputation for being nonviolent criminals. Rarely will you find a con artist stashing someone's head in her freezer. Her victims almost never end up dead. Almost never. This makes it awfully convenient for us, because we can dismiss these victims as gullible but largely unharmed idiots and focus all of our fawning attention on what makes the artists, criminals, so fabulous. But perhaps there's a darker reason we cheer on the con artist. Secretly, we want to be her. Most people, especially women, live their lives rattling around inside 1,001 social barriers. But through some mysterious alchemy of talent and criminality, The con artist bursts through those barriers like Houdini escaping from one of his famous suspended straitjackets. The con artist doesn't feel the need to use the correct social security number, or keep the name her parents gave her, or put her real eye color on her driver's license. She doesn't mind forgery. She's not afraid of a little bigamy. She'll drive a fancy car right off the parking lot, or steal a necklace made of 647 diamonds. And she doesn't care who pays the price for her crimes. And though people love to turn her into a metaphor for entrepreneurship, for capitalist grift, for the American dream, for America itself, for the devil, or simply for the average woman's life of mild duplicity, she doesn't give a damn about your figures of speech. The only person she answers to is herself. Isn't it shocking, that sort of naked selfishness? And doesn't it sound sort of delicious? It's tempting to think that we could be her, if we were better at accents and owned a few more wigs and gave in completely to our basest social desires for status, power, wealth, money, admiration, control. These desires may sound crass, but they're inherent to our nature. A recent psychology study found that people crave high social rank not only because it satisfies our aching need to belong, but because it gives us a sense of control, better self-esteem, and even reproductive benefits. Even animals want to be important. A 2016 study of female rhesus macaque monkeys showed that social climbing actually strengthened their immune systems. Most of us indulge these desires in milquetoast ways. Our tiny, depressing cons just never make the papers. We reinvent ourselves on New Year's Day. We edit our life stories to sound more exciting. And we try our very, very best to be likable when it benefits us. But we rarely let ourselves go all the way, whether through a sense of morality or social pressure or a good old-fashioned longing to stay out of jail. So when we read about the con woman's hijinks, it's tempting to put ourselves not in her victim's shoes. We're far too smart for that, we think. But in hers, what if we behaved like she does? What if we could charm like that? What if we shucked off morality and society and collective responsibility and just let ourselves indulge? But we could never be her. There's too much standing in our way, too many rules to follow, too many social contracts to uphold. This is a good thing, mostly, this following and upholding. A beautiful thing, even, though some of us will hopefully be forgiven for suppressing a small sigh of disappointment at the realization. And maybe that's why the con artist finds it so easy to make us like her. She has to turn on the charm, sure, but we're waiting to meet her with open mouths and shining eyes. As she performs for us, we think, a great human creature, and a wonderful, wonderful person, and what if, what if, what if? She has us right where she wants us. She's about to make us an offer we can't refuse. The Glitterati. 1. Jean de Saint-Remy. 2. Cassie Chadwick. 3. Wang Ti. Miscellanea. 1 hot air balloon. 1 hot air balloon-inspired product. 8 grand pianos. 647 plus diamonds, 1 fake queen, 2 fake fathers, 1 real fainting spell, numerous fake fainting spells, 1 soldier who loves calligraphy, 1 elderly man driven to his deathbed in shock, a batch of swindled Olympians, 1 fake mustache, 1 very significant rose. Jean de Saint-Remy. Alias. Comtesse de la Motte. 1756 through 1791. Once upon a time, the King of France decided to buy his lover the most beautiful diamond necklace in the world. The year was 1772. The king was the shy, awkward Louis XV, and his lover was Madame du Barry, whose flushed cheeks and milky décolletage were the stuff of legends. She needed a necklace worthy of her beauty. And so the royal jewelers got to work, sourcing diamonds from countries as far away as Russia and Brazil. The resulting 647 diamond, 2,800 carat confection was stunning and a bit ominous. It was designed to circle the wearer's throat and creep toward her bosom, while strands of diamonds poured down the back of her neck. There were a couple of frothy little blue ribbons scattered about the necklace, but they failed to soften the overwhelming effect. The style was called a collier d'esclavage, a slave collar. It should have been the most coveted piece of jewelry in the world, but Madame du Barry never had a chance to try it on. Before Louis XV could shell out the 2 million livres necessary to buy it, more than $17 million today, he died of smallpox, leaving his lover without her bauble and the panicked jewelers without a dime. For a while, the jewelers trudged around Europe, waving the necklace under various royal noses, but no one was charmed by its malicious twinkle. And even if they were, they couldn't afford it anyway. So the jewelers returned home to try one last option. There was a new girl in town, a young queen from Austria, famous for her elegant neck. She was said to be a frivolous thing, obsessed with anything that sparkled. Maybe she'd be interested in the piece. After all, what woman wouldn't want to get her hands on something so precious? 16 years earlier, a scrappy little girl was born into a world without diamonds. Her father was a drunk, her mother beat her with sticks, and her family had squandered their pathetic fortune generations ago. But her name. Her name was Jeanne de Saint-Rémy, proud descendant of the House of Valois, and her name meant everything to her. Jeanne's father was technically the great-great-great-grandson of Henry II, who ruled France in the mid-1500s as the 10th king of the House of Valois. But her father was an illegitimate great-great-great-grandson, descended from Henry II's mistress. And so while his forefathers had gotten some royal favor, his descendants suffered. For generations, Jean's bastard ancestors had lived as poachers and thieves in a dilapidated country home outside the village of Basserobe in Champagne. Gradually, most of their land was sold to absolve various debts, and by the time Jean and her three siblings came along, there was no Valois glitter left. In fact, the kids were so thin and feral that locals found them difficult to look at. There was a little hole in the wall of the shack where they lived, and the locals would shove food through the hole at the children, so as not to see their starving faces. But Jean grew up believing that there was Valois money waiting in the wings for her, as long as she could convince someone important to listen. Her parents supported this delusion in their own poisonous ways. When their debts became serious enough, the whole family fled to Paris, where Jean's mother forced her to beg, beating her viciously if she didn't bring home enough money. Jean would wander the streets, crying, "Pity a poor orphan of the blood of the Valois." In Paris, her father died of alcoholism, and Jean claimed that his last words to her included the exhortation, "Let me beg you, under every misfortune, to remember that you are a Valois." When she was 8 years old, her cry caught the ear of a generous lady called the Marchioness de Boulainvilliers, who scooped up Jean and her siblings, scrubbed them behind their ears, and sent them off to boarding school. By this point, Jean's mother had run off with another man. The Marchioness even managed to get the children's Valois heritage authenticated and wrangled a small royal pension for them, the equivalent of about $8,000 annually today. This should have been a huge deal for Jean, royal acknowledgement that she was who she said she was. But the ambitious girl was practically insulted by the gesture. She wanted real money. She wanted the Valois country home back. She wanted people to look at her in awe. Though France was crumbling internally, pouring money into the American Revolution to destabilize their English enemy, and only about a decade away from their own bloody insurrection, the country's upper class was still glamorous enough to dazzle even the most level-headed young woman. At the center of all that glamour was the young queen Marie Antoinette, who shamelessly overspent her clothing budget, wore huge sculpted hairstyles, kept her own personal chocolate maker on call, and hired someone to make sure that her rooms were always filled with fresh flowers. With a queen like that, who wouldn't want a piece of the glamour for herself? Everyone in the country was striving for more, stepping shamelessly on the heads of those below them in order to rise up another fraction of an inch. And no one in the entire hungry, scrabbling country wanted to climb higher than Jean. Charles Beaumet was surrounded by so many diamonds that he wanted to kill himself. He and his partner, Paul Bassange, were the royal jewelers who had designed the 647 diamond necklace that, as it turned out, had been the worst mistake of their professional lives. The thing was cursed. Cursed! They'd spent the last 10 years begging Marie Antoinette to take the necklace off their hands, and the queen had yet to express the slightest interest in it. At one point, Beaumet flung himself onto the floor in front of her and sobbed that if she didn't buy the necklace from him, he would throw himself into the river. The queen responded coolly that she certainly wouldn't hold herself responsible if he died. It should have been clear to Beaumet that he was barking up the wrong tree. Marie Antoinette almost never wore necklaces.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.